So welcome to lecture number 13 of the course. Today we'll discuss spin. Well, spin is often this rather mystic quantity of which you mostly say that in classical physics it doesn't exist and so on and so forth. Today I try to present one avenue towards it that, like maybe a few others, try to demystify it by particularly spelling out what the logic behind it is, and by maybe using terminology which is more or less the standard terminology, however in one or two places deviates from it, in order not to give the wrong impressions, which then mystifies the subject rather than demystify it. Well, it starts all very innocently, namely by noting that in the previous lecture, at the end, we used Stone's theorem to define angular momentum. So we defined angular momentum, and here I would like to give it a more precise name, as it's also often called in literature. We defined orbital angular momentum. So maybe last time I should have said we defined the orbital angular momentum operator. But anyway, that's what we did. And well, so there's the first thing, a bit of terminology here. So momentum is not momentar, so that's singular. But one usually means by it a collection of three operators, namely these Li's that we had last time. So if you have Li from I 1 to 3, you say you have the angular momentum operator. Of course, the idea is that you say this is actually a vector consisting of L1, L2, L3. Well, it is not a vector. It's also not an operator-valued vector. However, this terminology stems from there, that you say have one angular momentum. Okay, so I will use it in that form. If I say angular momentum operator, I mean these three operators. It's the first little terminological hurdle. Okay, so fine, that's not too bad. And Stone's theorem gave us the domains DLI Stone such that these angular momentum operators over L2 are self-adjoint. Okay? Self-adjoint. So they are indeed quantum mechanical observables. All this was quite well. And they were given by these three expressions, L1 equals minus I, X2 del 3 psi, okay, if they act on a psi, minus X3 del 2 psi, L2 as minus I, X3 del 1 psi, minus X1 del 3 psi, and finally L3 psi is minus 1 X1 del 2 psi minus x2 del 1 psi. There they are. So this we got from Stone's theorem, from this construction of this unitary. Now, we also saw that by this corollary of Stone's theorem we had, we may compromise self-adjointness but keeping essential self-adjointness to gain a domain equals a range, meaning that the Li's go from, well, I think I used the Latin S, that you start in Schwarz space and you go to Schwarz space, so that the range is also Schwarz space. Okay? And you see the advantage of this is once you do that, you may formulate commutation relations. Then one can calculate L1, comma L2. If I restrict attention to psis that come from Schwarz space, for psi in Schwarz. So what was this commutator? This is the definition of the commutator. This is L1 after L2 minus L2 after L1. And here you see the reason why I needed to restrict to this domain of essential self-adjointness, because only then do I know that the first, if this one acts on the psi, it will yield something that this guy can eat. Okay? So we have this, and to make it blatantly obvious, well, you know that this is always is an operator acts on this, but that usually here we save brackets by not always writing the argument in brackets. But this is, of course, L1 of L2 psi minus L2 of L1 psi, like this, right? So this is the definition of the composition, and we may now simply calculate this. So we plug this in, okay? So what is this? The L1, let's calculate this for L1, L2. This is minus I bracket L1 is x2 del 3 minus x3 del 2 acting on, so it acts on this L2 psi, but L2 psi is minus I times x3 del 1 psi minus x1 del 3 psi. That's this. And that acts on that. And then the whole thing is subtracted here, minus L2, L1. We have to write this down again. So this is then minus minus I is plus I. L2 is x3 del 1 minus x1 del 3. Acting on minus I times the L1 is x2 del 3 psi minus x3 del 2 psi. Finished. I'm just plugging this in, okay? So now we have to execute this in disciplined manner. So you see here this del 1 psi is actually del 1 psi. You calculate this and then you evaluate at x, of course. I'm not writing all these x's. And then you act again from the front with derivative operator. So you have to be careful. Occasionally, you will have to obey a product rule. Okay, so already this first term. So let's execute this. So, well, first of all, these are linear, this acts linearly. So this minus I can jump to the front. So it's minus I squared, and this minus I goes. Okay, that helps. It's this. And here this minus I jumps in front. Minus I squared is a plus 1. Jumps in front. This goes. And up here, the minus I squared is a minus 1. So there's a minus here, okay? So now let's, was okay? So now let's particularly look at this first term as it acts on this first term, because there we see already what I mean. So we have the minus from here, we have the x2, nothing happens, and now the del 3 acts on this entire product. But already the first entry is an x, the first factor is an x3. So del 3 on x3 yields a 1, okay? And then del 1 psi survives, plus product rule, the x3 stays there, and the del 3 acts on the del 1 psi. So that's a del 3, del 1 is the second derivative, psi, okay? And that's the first term that comes by application of this first one on that first one. Okay, and in this fashion, we now execute this. However, we'll see most of these terms, you don't need to obey any product rule at all. So now we take the first one and apply it to the second. Minus times minus is plus. X2 acts, okay? then del 3 on this product, but the del 3 goes through this thing without seeing it, because for the derivative in the 3 direction, the x1 is a constant, right? Partial differentiation. So that goes through it. So that's del 3 psi. There you go. That's it. Done. Next term. Minus times minus is plus. X3, del 2 acting on this guy. Well, that's another x3, del 2, del 1 psi. Minus, minus, minus is a minus. X3, x1, del 2, del 3 psi. There we go. So we executed the first line from here. So now we go to the second line. Plus x3, del 1 acting on the first one, doesn't see the x2, so it's x2, del 1, del 3 on psi, minus x3, del 1, del 2 acting on the psi. Last two terms, plus, minus, minus, x1, del, x1, x2, del 3, del 3 psi, minus minus is plus. Aha, here we again have a del 3 acting on a del 3. So once more, there is a product rule. It's x1 acting on 1 times del 2 psi plus, product rule, x3 del 3 del 2 psi. Okay, and if I didn't mix up any signs, we should have a whole number of cancellations. So let's see. We have an x2, x3 term. Do we have another one of those? Yes, we have one here. This one has x2, x3, del 3, del 1. This is x2, del 3, del 1, del 3, but because of the Schwarz rule, because these guys are certainly in C infinity from its definition, so, and Schwarz rules apply from C2 onwards, we can swap. So actually this term, and so this is this, and this lies in C2 R3, and hence we can apply the Schwarz rule. That's the logic. Del 1, del 3, that's this one, and that one, this has a minus sign in front, this one doesn't, so this term cancels this term. Next term, we have an x2, x1 term. Do we have another one? X2, x1, yes, there's one x2, x1, del 3, del 3, del 3, del 3, plus, minus, this one goes against that one. Fantastic. We have an x3, x1 term. We have another one, yes, here, x3, x1, del 3, del 2, del 2, del 3, different signs, Schwarz rule applies, this one goes against that one. And finally, we have an x3, x3 term, there's its counterpart, Schwarz rule, opposite sign, this one goes against that one, and all that remains are these two terms here. It's this one, it's minus x2 del 1 psi, it's the one from here, and the one from down there, plus x1 del 2 psi. Now I claim that this is I times L3. Is that right? What is L3? L3 is that guy. I times makes a plus is x1 del 2 minus x2 del 1. That's right. Aha! So we derived, and there's a psi. Of course, it acts on psi. So we derived, we started here, and we ended up here. So we derived these commutation relations, but I emphasize again, for all psi in the Schwarz space, so on this domain of essential self-adjointness. You couldn't write this down on all of L2. Well, if the L's were defined on all of L2, you couldn't normally write it down on all of the stone domain. Okay, so that's an easy enough calculation. It's a very standard calculation from the textbooks. The only thing we did, we paid a little more attention to the domain. But that was essentially application of what was said yesterday. Now, obviously, you can't only do that. You can do this also for L2, L3, and L3, L1. So you can calculate the pairwise commutators over the Schwarz space. And obviously, similarly, you get the others. Similarly, for the others, and now, however, I write them down again in total. L1, L2 is I, L3. L2, L3 is I, L1. And finally, L3, L1 is I, L2. Okay? Now, on Schwarz space. Now, let's observe something. It could have happened that I take L1 and L2 and I land somewhere else but the L3. It could have been a totally different operator. It could have been five times the identity or something. What you see here, these three commute amongst each other and the result always is one of them. Okay? So we have this, and one says that the vector space of L1, L2, L3 spanned by L1, L2, L3 with this commutator is a Lie algebra. We don't need this. Sometimes people call this the orbital angular momentum algebra, and we will call it the same. This is the orbital angular momentum algebra. Okay. Aha. So why do people make such a fuss about it? Because after all, didn't we define the L1, L2, L3? We had the full operator by virtue of their definition. They had a domain and everything was given. And this is just a consequence of their definition. So why do you make such a fuss about this consequence? Well, in fact, you don't need to. If you, for instance, want to know the spectrum of the angular momentum algebra, so remark, without calculating these commutators, so without, one could already conclude the following. One could already conclude that the spectrum of any of the LIs, doesn't matter which one, 1, 2, 3, if this is the orbital angular momentum, so I emphasize it again, because later on we'll have different operators with the same algebra, which however are not the orbital angular momenta. Right? This guy Well, you can certainly conclude that it lies in Z. So the spectrum is discrete. Okay, you can conclude this for the orbital angular momentum. Why? Well, because we know from the definition from last time, we know that e to the I 2 pi Li, well, Li, I is a J. I mean, the I is, of course, also the comment, so index j, e to the I 2 pi lj is the identity on, well, wherever you act. Wherever you act. This is the unitary, right? This is a generator for the unitary. So we know it's the identity on h, right? So this we know from the definition of these guys as the generators of these unitaries, right? Via Stone's theorem. And we know if this is true, you can decompose the left-hand side by the spectral theorem. You can write this as E, because you know that these guys are self-adjoint, E 2 pi lambda, E to the I 2 pi lambda, P, and that's the P of the LJ. It's a self-adjoint operator, so we can construct these spectral measures. D lambda. Okay, but if this is supposed to be the identity, you know that the identity is given by simply taking all the P L J D lambda. you know that that must be the identity that was one of the properties of these guys, if there's nothing in front. And then you see that the lambdas must be in Z in order to satisfy this. Okay? So we can, for concrete, that's my point, we know much more than this. For the concrete orbital angular momentum, we know the domain, we know the exact definition, we know where it comes from, we know the unitaries generated by it, okay? We know all of this. And from all of this, we can learn the spectrum. So why do people ever calculate these commutation relations? Maybe it may come in useful at some point. Well, there is a little twist to it. The twist to it is the following, that angular momentum, orbital angular momentum, as we defined it, which is the generator of what rotates your wave function in physical space and corresponds to the classical observable of angular momentum of a particle trajectory with respect to some point, orbital angular momentum is just one possible operator in quantum mechanics that satisfies these commutation relations. What I mean, it's just one possible operator. Well, in quantum mechanical systems in the lab, you have opportunity to have systems that have nothing to do with the particle moving in R3, has nothing to do with any R3 space. I'll comment on that in a second. I'll give an example, which are defined totally differently from orbital angular momentum, have very different domains, maybe finite dimensional Hilbert space and so on. The actual definition which we used here is very different, has nothing to do with differential operators, nothing. Okay. But they have the same commutation relations. Aha. So it is simply economical, once and for all, to see what can be concluded from the commutation relations alone, because in other instances they also appear, and what is a specific extra information beyond that that comes from the precise definition of the operators in there. Let me write this down. So that's the first section. I call it a general spin, or I should say, like in the literature, angular momentum. Where now it doesn't say orbital angular momentum, you see. So orbital angular momentum are the very specific operators I introduced last time with those domains and so on. And now the literature then generalizes this to general angular momentum operators. And because here you still have the idea that it has something to do with the orbital angular momentum, I immediately call it spin. Okay, so general spin, general angular momentum. So the observation is the following, and that's something you just observe as you go along, but of course you take my word for it. Observation, there are quantum mechanical systems with observables, and let me call them, S1, S2, S3, defined on some domain, on some domain of at least essential self-adjointness. So the SI, they go from some D into D. Well, let's do it like this, from D into D, that lie in the Hilbert space of that system. Whatever that Hilbert space is, it will not be necessarily L2. Defined somehow, and by somehow I mean however they are defined, okay? I don't need to specify because any definition is good. Which also have commutation relations like the ones above. So meaning S1, S2, Si, S3, S2, S3, Si, S1, and S3, S1, Si, S2 on this domain. But which are not orbital angular momentum. Well, of course, because then H would have to be L of R2 and D would have to be the Schwarz space, okay? And you would have to have a definition, precise definition too. Okay, so there are others that have the same commutation relations. And before I continue further with this general statement, I'll give you an example. Example. The domain D is already the whole Hilbert space, and the whole Hilbert space is just C2 with the inner product given by, well, here the psi and the phi are elements of C2. I think we had this before. You take I equals 1 to 2, the ith component, so this is, of course, a pair, psi 1, psi 2. This is a pair, phi 1, phi 2, well, pair of complex numbers. And you take this inner product here. Okay? So you have this C2 complex vector space, which is, of course, a Hilbert space. And the operators I'm talking about are S1 is 1 half times 0, 1, 1, 0. S2 is 1 half, mustn't forget the 1 half, 1 half minus II of diagonal. And S3 is 1 half, 1 minus 1 diagonal. So some people call these guys here without the 1 half, without the 1 half, they call them the Pauli sigma matrices, sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3. And so the operators I'm talking about are 1 half times the Pauli sigma matrices. And for some reason, we always have to carry them around because they have this name attached to them. But anyway, it's just, you can forget this comment. So I have a Hilbert space. I have, well, linear operators on them that act on these pairs in the standard fashion by matrix multiplication, blah, 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 blah. And you can check the commutation relations I claimed are satisfied. Okay. Aha. What does this have to do with a particle on R3, an L2 space, angular, orbital angular momentum? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. A finite dimensional, a two-dimensional Hilbert space with this inner product, these guys, they have the same commutation relations. Remark. As we will see later from the terminology, this is a spin one-half system, a so-called spin one-half system. Okay. There's nothing simpler than that. We'll have a general terminology of a spin J system later on. This is just a remark, right? So I put it in quotation marks. So now it's a question, as I said, it's nothing deep. It's just a question of being economical that we do not discuss angular momentum and spin one half and what other possible other spaces there could still be. There are many others that where you have three operators that satisfy these commutation relations. We will once and for all determine what we can learn from the commutation relations. So. It's a remark. Another remark. The idea, it is economical. to determine what can be learned, e.g., about the spectrum of any set of three observables on whatever D in whatever H and with whatever concrete definition. Well, so I already gave you two concretely defined examples. One was the angular momentum, and one so were the L operators, L1, L2, L3. Now I gave you three other concrete ones, S1, S2, S3, with a concrete domain and so on. So this was twice something very concrete. But the question is, what if you don't know exactly what the domain is? Or not, if you don't know at all what the domain is or the Hilbert space in which the domain lies densely, if you don't know at all the specific definition of the operators, what if you would only restrict yourself to knowing that they have these commutation relations? Question: can you expect from the commutation relations alone to learn everything about the spectrum of such a triple of operators? No, you cannot necessarily expect it, because if you have the precise definition of these operators with their domains and everything, you can infer the commutation relations, like we did for orbital angular momentum, like you could very easily do for this. Starting here, so the concrete definition yields such commutation. But such commutation can come from different concrete implementations, concrete definitions. So hence, you cannot infer back. Very clear. So, well, it could be that this already contains everything. Some quantum mechanics books claim that. It's all about the commutation relations. No. It's not all about the commutation relations. And in fact, these guys have a different spectrum than the orbital angular momentum. But because they have the same commutation relations, whatever we can infer from the commutation relations about the spectrum must be true for the spectrum of any concrete realization. Okay? That's the strategy. Let's learn as much as we can from the commutation relations. That's the whole idea for the next section. Okay? This is very often confused because people call this an angular momentum algebra, or they call it general spin or general angular momentum, call this an angular momentum algebra. You had this example of angular momentum last time, and you say then there are different realizations of it. What does that really mean? Okay, well, if you come this route, you know what that really means. But it's not all in here. This is just not true. It's just an artificial restriction in order to be economical to say, let's assume we only know the commutation relations. Whatever can be learned about the spectrum, or anything else, but we are mainly interested in the spectra, can be learned about the spectrum of the any concrete, now I introduce the next set of symbols, of any concrete set J1, J2, J3, which are defined on some domain back into the domain on some Hilbert space. So this is the whatever, with whatever concrete definition, okay? Whatever can be learned about the spectrum of any concrete set with the said commutation relations. I'm not going to write them down once more. whatever can be learned about the spectrum of any concrete set by only considering the commutation relations must obviously be true for the actual concrete set of operators. So, in fact, we will now show. We'll now show the following. We'll show that the pure point spectrum. You remember the pure point spectrum of an operator. The pure point spectrum of an operator was the set of eigenvalues. Remember? The spectrum is more than the set of eigenvalues, but the pure point spectrum is just the set of eigenvalues. We learn that the pure point spectrum of any j, of the j1 and the j2 and the j3, that satisfy these three commutation relations, must always lie in z half. What is that? Well, that's the set zero minus one half plus one half minus one plus one and so on. So all half integers, any of these guys has eigenvalues that are certainly half integer. So eigenvalue 3/4 does not exist for any of those. I didn't write equal because this is true for any j with these commutation relations. While from the concrete definitions, we learn, well, let's take concrete definitions. I can take the Lj operator, the L1 or the L2 or the L3, and I can calculate the entire spectrum. We'll do this on a problem sheet. So this we'll do today in the lectures. And then you can take, however, the concrete definition, and you will find that the entire spectrum, well, I think I said it already, that the entire spectrum is actually, well, I said it's in Z, that the entire spectrum is Z. Aha! Well, that makes sense. I said for any operators with these commutation relations, the spectrum is half integer. Well, for orbital angular momentum, it's even integer. So there is never an eigenvalue for L1 that is minus 1/2. But it could be minus 1 or minus 10,000. Okay? So the orbital angular momentum eigenvalues, and in fact the whole spectrum, it's a pure point spectrum, can only be full integer, not half integer. But of course, this is perfectly compatible with it, that the pure point spectrum of this guy lies in z half. Well, because z lies in z half. Okay? So that's consistent. Now let's do the other example. And the spectrum, what about these guys that I wrote down? These spin 1/2s. So I can take any of them as j. J equals 1, 2, or 3. If I would measure any one of them, I can't measure them all at the same time, but if I measure any one of them, what would be the spectrum? Well, it turns out the spectrum could only be minus 1/2 and plus 1/2. Aha! So you see, the spectrum of the orbital angular momentum are all the integers, and the spectrum of these guys, the SJs, They're minus one half and plus one half. This spectrum has zero overlap with this spectrum. They're totally different spectra, although they have the same commutation relations. Well, it's a German subject to an extent. Although they have the same commutation relations. But I didn't claim that. So if somebody says it's all in the commutation relations, you give them these two examples, and you say, no, it isn't. Not at all. But whatever we learn, in this case about the pure point spectrum of these guys, that's compatible. Z lies in Z half, and minus one half plus one half also lies in Z half. And this is what you learn from the commutation relations alone. Can be learned from the commutation relations alone. So we will learn it. Okay? So that's the logical status of what we're going to do. Recall that it was immediate from the concrete definition of the LJs with this e to the I 2 pi LJ is the identity. It was immediate that the spectrum lies in Z. Then you work a little harder and then you see it even equals Z. So if you have a concrete set of three operators given with these commutation relations, they are usually very quick routes, sometimes not so quick, to arrive at the result. Okay? But we have the full domains, you have the exact definition. But now we rid ourselves of the full domains, of knowing the domain, of knowing even the Hilbert space in which this happens. We rid ourselves of an exact definition. We only have the commutation relations. So we obviously have to be very smart about getting information out of it. Okay? So how is this smartness going? So what I'm going to present now is the derivation of this result. Derivation of the fact that the pure point spectrum of any of the LJs lies in Z half. Okay? What I'm going to present now at first sight seems rather complicated. Okay? I mean, it's a standard thing you find in any quantum mechanics textbook. It's rather complicated, and one could think, oh my god, this angular momentum is really a special kind of thing because it's so complicated to extract its spectrum. No, it's only because we restrict ourselves artificially to only using the commutation relations. Otherwise, it may be very quick. Okay? So don't think, oh, the angular momentum works like this, I would have never found this. Now, who knows what other operators have to be treated in what way. Okay, so this slight complication comes only because of that, but it's very useful to do that. Okay, so, well, let's start. So we start from having operators, JJ, okay, 1, 2, 3, defined on some domain, into some domain, on some Hilbert space with whatever definition with J1, J2, IJ3, J2, J3, IJ1, J3, J1, IJ2. What do we do? Well, as I said, to compensate for the lack of information, because I don't tell you what this is and that is and so on, we have to be clever, and so we have to make a number of observations. Each of them is trivial, and the sequence of them is a matter of trying for a while. So anyway, I present this. So observations. So the first one is that you can define a new operator omega, and that new operator is defined as J1 after J1 plus J2 after J2 plus J3 after J3. In the literature, this is very often called J vector, with the idea it has the J1, J2, J3 in it. and then you square it. So the literature very often calls this thing J vector squared. I call it omega. It's simply a new operator that you have. Because you go from D to D, you can apply it once and then again and so on, and you construct this thing. Now, why would you construct this guy? Well, that's not clear for a while, for a short moment at least. But let's make the key observation about this operator. So the techniques here to find the spectrum of any such general angular momentum or spin set of observables generalizes to other cases. So if you see a little bit behind the superficial construction, this is quite useful as a strategy, but I'll comment as we go along. And the key observation one, is that this omega commutes with any of the J1, J2, J3. So you know, neither of the J's commutes with any other of the J's. But this very specific combination commutes with all the J's without being the zero operator. Okay. So remark, this is just for future reference if you see the terminology, such an operator, omega, that commuting with every element in the span of a certain set of operators, which is here this guy, is called a Casimir operator. For the Lie algebra with this vector space and a given commutator bracket, okay, is called a Casimir operator. For this, one calls this a Lie algebra. This is just a remark aside. We don't need that terminology. It's just that this sometimes comes up, and then you know, this is like in the angular momentum strategy. Okay. So further, that's the first observation. We collect a few facts, and then it's easier to present. Further, it is instructive. Well, usually it's not very instructive to say that something is instructive because I don't tell you why it is instructive. Well, as we go along, you'll see. Further, it's instructive to define. Well, it's instructive to, useful, whatever, to consider the set of operators J plus, which is defined by J1 plus IJ2, J minus, which is defined as J1 minus IJ2, and J3, which remains J3. Okay. To consider this set of three operators in place of, so instead of J1, J2, and J3. What do I mean by that? Well, obviously, we are dealing with J1, J2, J3. None of them seems in any way special. If you look at the, and none of them is, if you look at the commutation relations, they cyclically, there's not, J3 is not special, is it? And in fact, I could have defined J plus and J minus with J2 and J3 instead of J1 and J2. And then I would have kept J1 the same. So there are several ways you can take these three guys. And this choice here, in a sense, breaks the symmetry between them, because this one is still Well, think, for instance, of this finite-dimensional space. This one is still self-adjoint, whereas these guys are linear combinations with complex numbers that will not, J plus star will not be J plus. In fact, J plus star will be J minus. Under starring, these two go into each other, whereas under starring, each of them stays what it is because they're observables. So we choose, it's just for technical convenience, to not look at these three observables, but we choose to keep one of them, to single out one of them, and of the other two to make two non-observables because they're no longer self-adjoint. Well, that sounds like a very strange strategy, but it's very useful, and you'll see. You just shouldn't think that J3 in any way is special. You could have done it with any of the other two if you look carefully at it, how you do that, okay? And so a priori, it's not clear that that's a good strategy, but it's not wrong either because, and now that's the point, once you have J2, J minus, and J plus, J minus, and J3, you can, of course, take 1/2 times the sum of these two, and you get J1 back. Or you can take 1/2, 1 over 2i times the difference, and you get J2 back. So you don't lose information. Let's single out the J3, just for fun, okay? It gets us, yields us insight, okay? So we do that, and then we can actually calculate for this new set. You see, I could also say change bases in this vector space, but this is the vector space with real coefficients, and now I go to a complexified version of it. It is not clear that that's a good idea, but it is. One quickly calculates, and I'm not going to do that because this is really just one-liners, more or less. One quickly calculates that if you take the J plus and you commute it with the J minus, well, you plug in the definitions, you use the composition that these are linear maps and blah, 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 you find that the result is 2 times J3. Okay, well, that makes kind of sense in a J plus and J minus. There are J1 and J2s in there, and you get the J3s. And the I's take care of the I that is killed by that. And then you find that if you take J3 and you commute it with the J plus, that you get the J plus. Uh-huh. And you find that if you take the J3 and you commute it with the J minus, and that completes all possible combinations, because if you take the opposite order, you just pick up a minus sign, right? Then you get the J minus, well, not quite, with an extra minus sign. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, again, these commutation relations contain the same information as the commutation relations we started from. Okay? Because you have chosen a new basis on this space, and you have all the commutation relations that contains the same information. Okay, I should maybe write that. Contains same info as, okay, J1, J2 is IJ3 dot dot. Okay, I'm not going to write them down again. Why? Well, we calculated those from here. This is what we just did. Well, but now you can calculate these by expressing J1 and J2 in terms of these linear combinations, and you can go in that direction. If you can go in both directions, you contain the same information. Okay? That's it. Contains the same info. Mm-hmm. And the omega equally commutes with the J plus, and the omega commutes with the J minus. No big surprise, and it also, of course, still, nothing changed, commutes with the J3. Okay, you know that we introduced this extra Casimir operator omega. These are all just very simple facts. Once we go down this route, this is just immediate. Mm-hmm. The second key observation obviously, there's no difference between an observation and a key observation, other than that you pay more attention if I say it's a key observation. The key observation is that the omega can be written in two ways. Omega can be written in two ways using the J plus, the J minus, and the J3. So with the J1, J2, J3, there was just more or less one way. Well, there was one way. But now you can write omega either or. It's really the same as J plus, J minus. Of course, if I write nothing, there's always a circ between them. Plus J3 times J3 minus the identity on, well, on our domain, id d. I think this is the right signs. Yes, that's right. Okay. So I leave out these circs. You know these are maps. Or J minus J plus, so the opposite order here in front. And then, but here again, J3, J3 plus the identity D. Well, both true. So not one in one case and the other one in the other case. They're simply both true. So now before we proceed, let me comment on why we are so eager to bring omega into the game or into play. You could say, what is it with this omega? You want to calculate the spectrum of J, say J3. That's what we want to do. We want to know what's the spectrum of J3. If you have that, we can do a similar strategy to calculate the one of J1 and J2. Why do we invent another operator? Don't we have enough to do with calculating the spectrum of one of them? Well, the point is, we'll make the problem seemingly more difficult, but in fact much easier. Answer? To make the problem seemingly, so not really, seemingly more complicated by now asking not only for the eigenvectors. Well, you say, we don't want eigenvectors, we actually want to find eigenvalues. Well, you find eigenvalues by finding eigenvectors, right? That goes hand in hand. You know how you had eigenvectors and eigenvalues, right? I mean, that everyone knows. The eigenvectors, by now asking not only for the eigenvectors of J3, say, but even for common eigenvectors of J3 and omega. You say, Jesus, wouldn't it be enough if you asked me to find the eigenvectors of the J3? Now you pose an even more difficult question, it seems, to calculate the ones of J3 that at the same time are eigenvalues of the omega. Is it really more complicated? Well, let's see. Let me formulate the problem. So we look for, what is an eigenvector? An eigenvector is a psi that lies in the domain of the operators. That should certainly be true. But an eigenvector is never a zero vector. The zero vector is not an eigenvector by definition, and that's a very meaningful, useful definition. So we're looking for guys psi that satisfy they are an eigenvalue of the J3. Well, if they're an eigenvector, if they're an eigenvector, then there will be an eigenvalue, let's call it mu. And at the same time, this James psi is supposed to be an eigenvector of the omega with, of course, normally a different eigenvalue lambda. We're actually only interested in these mu's. We just would be very happy if we just got the mu's. And I say, no, take a commuting operator and try to get the eigenvalues, the eigenvectors that are common to the two of them. Why is this a clever idea? Well, whenever you want to derive something, the more equations you have, the more conclusions you can draw. By constructing a commuting commuting operator, you know from linear algebra that only then can you find common eigenvectors. It's the theorem of linear algebra. Okay, you can also see quite easily why that's the case. But if we can construct such a guy, it would be just silly to not use that as an extra constraint on the very same eigenvectors I'm looking for. Okay, because this gives us further information. Okay, so we're doing that. In fact, if our problem was such that there were even more Casimir operators, an omega 1 but yet another omega 2 that also commutes with all the j's, I would have added that as well, because then I have three equations that I can use. While this is still what I want to solve for, right? It's just very clever to find all the Casimir operators in your problem. To find all the operators that commute with all the operators you were looking at in the first place. In the hydrogen atom, you will do that. In the hydrogen atom, you will also have the Hamiltonian, the energy of the system, okay? And you will want to find the angular momentum and stuff like that. You will use that the energy commutes with these guys as well, beyond this omega here, so you have yet another equation. So you will use as many commuting operators that you find, operators that commute with every operator you looked at in your algebra. Okay? So that is why we introduce a second, or a fourth in that case, operator that commutes with all the ones we already had, because it gives us extra equations for free, which we can use. And so you say, well, you need to find these guys. Yeah, that's true. And we have to do that to compensate for our lack of information because we don't know the domain, we don't know the Hilbert space, we don't know the concrete definition of these operators J, we just know their commutation relations. So there's a lot of information not there if we look at it so generally. We somehow need to compensate for that, and that one can compensate for it allows us to look at the commutation relations in the first place. Okay? When would it not be possible? So I'm diverging a little bit, but when would it not be possible or not likely to do such a trick? Well, if you had an algebra where on the right-hand side there would be lots of zeros. So not the first one gives J1, the next one J2, the next one J3, but two of them would be zero or so. Then the commutation relations contain so little information that usually you can't pull off such a trick. Okay? So, well, anyway, so, fine. Okay, so we're looking for the common eigenvectors, and if we want to do that, of course, it will depend which psi solves this. The eigenvector will depend on the mu here. So for every mu, you will have at least one eigenvector here. And it will also depend on the lambda. So the common eigenvectors, we can label them by a pair, lambda mu, which says the psi lambda mu is a common eigenvector to J3 and omega, namely with eigenvalue mu for J3 and eigenvector lambda for the omega. Okay? So let's introduce this labeling system. At times I will suppress it, because it just increases the writing, but in order to keep control of how many different vectors there could be, it's clever to do that, okay? So at least keep it in mind, or sometimes I'll insert it, the blue stuff, and if I leave it out, you insert it either yourself in some color, or you just think it, it will become important again. Okay. But to lighten the notation, I will occasionally just omit it. Aha. So we have this idea of finding the common eigenvectors. And now it's again, I'm sorry, again a string of observations, and we put them all together. In the end, para, we have the result. Uh-huh. Good. So, thus, we get... Let's take the lambda, that's an eigenvalue, and let's apply this to the psi, so I'll write it once here, to the psi eigenvalue lambda mu, comma psi lambda mu. So let's apply it to that one and not to any other. We didn't talk about them being normalized to anything, we just take this here. This is equal, I can let this jump into here, right? So this is equal to psi lambda mu, comma, lambda times this guy, I can write as omega psi lambda mu. Agree? I used one of the eigenvalue equations. But now we use the two ways here in which I can write the omega. I have these two ways. So we get psi lambda comma mu, comma, and I insert the first way to write the omega. I write it as j plus, j minus, plus j3, j3, minus the identity, and all of that, well, let me write it in square bracket, so there's no commutator, I just want another bracket, applied to psi lambda comma mu. And equally below, the second version, so they are fully equivalent, it's just two ways to write it, but it's important to look at both of them. First j minus, then j plus j3, j3 plus the identity acting on the psi, well, not any psi, but the psi lambda mu, is this. So nothing happened. We just used these two ways to write the omega. Well, now we can expand this again. We can take the j plus and the j minus. We can write them as the j1 plus the ij2 and so on. And then we can start pulling operators over here. But it's clever to first rewrite as J1, J2. Because of the J1, J2, we know that they are self-adjoint, right? So those we can pull over to the other side. And there are some I's. But you know, you can also pull an I to the other side if it gets a sign inside the inner product, blah, blah, blah. And if you do that, you find that actually this J plus goes over here. And it gets a star, informally speaking, it gets a star and it becomes a J minus, but you can do this bit by bit. So you get a J minus psi lambda mu on the left-hand side. And if I only, I can, of course, split this here in an extra inner product with over this plus. And on the right-hand side, you also keep a J minus psi lambda mu. And there you close the inner product. But then, of course, you need to also deal with that bit. But that bit is a plus. Now this, you can immediately let it act. This acts by the J3, produces a mu. And if you let this act, what you get is mu times mu minus 1 over here. And you get a inner product psi lambda comma mu. Okay? This is simply using the eigenvalue equations if you decompose this guy here according to the standard rules for the inner product using the bilinearity of the, well, the sesquilinearity of the emission in our product. And down here, you have a similar thing. You take this over here by decomposing J1, J2, using the self-adjoint, blah, blah, blah. Effectively, if the J minus jumps, it becomes a J plus. It's a J plus psi lambda comma mu. And then remains here a J plus psi lambda comma mu, okay, plus mu times mu plus 1, mu times mu plus 1 at the end of the day. And here psi lambda comma mu, lambda comma mu. Aha! But now you look at both sides of this equation. Well, we have two equations at the same time. I can solve for lambda. Hence, there are two ways to represent lambda, because I can divide by this inner product. Why can I divide by this inner product of the psi with itself?
Because it's positive, it's non-zero.
Because the psi is non-zero, because the psi is an eigenvector. Mm-hmm. Eigenvectors are never the zero vector, but only for the zero vector would this be zero, blah, blah, blah. You can divide. Okay, so then you get here, you get two possible ways to represent this. This guy here, of course, so this is just the norm of J minus on the psi lambda mu squared plus, well, and this guy here appears exactly like here again, so now only mu times mu minus 1 survives. And down here, the second way to represent the lambda is J plus psi lambda comma mu squared plus mu times mu plus 1. Okay? So that's the two ways to represent the lambda.
Mm-hmm. Could you explain your first term?
My first term. This one?
No, you're from lambda. You have two terms on your first term. I didn't get it. Because I think you have forgotten something.
Uh-huh.
Because you kind of take the norm to the other side, and then once you leave it out, and here you kind of have to divide through it.
Ah, yeah. You're right. Thank you. So this is divided by the norm of psi, the norm squared of psi lambda comma mu, right? And this factor here is divided by the norm, thank you, squared lambda comma mu, because I divide this over here. Here I divided, there I didn't, okay? So the plus is, of course, at the level of the fraction here, okay? Plus mu times mu plus 1 plus mu times mu minus 1. No, exactly the other way around. Minus plus. Okay? So we have that. Now, what do we read of? So this is something we're going to use again. That's a valuable equation dollar. We'll have a valuable inequality following from it. And we'll use both the inequality in that. This first term here is always positive. No, it's non-negative, right? And this term here is also always non-negative. Hence, because these terms here are always non-negative, we know that lambda is equal or larger than mu times mu minus 1, but it's also equal or larger than mu times mu plus 1. Right? That follows. Because if I leave out the first term, I make the right-hand side smaller, but the first term could be 0. Aha. Now, So, now, let's write these two separately. That means lambda greater or equal than mu times mu minus 1 lambda greater equal than mu times mu plus 1. Well, what I can do in this first one, I can write minus mu, I factor out a minus 1. Well, then of course I pick up a minus 1 for this plus, and I have a plus where I had a minus here. Okay, I factor out minus 1. That's not a big trick. But now you see, of course, there's an equal sign. So the important erasing technique yields this. And so I can combine these two. Well, I put this here as minus mu times minus mu plus 1. Okay. And then I can combine that again by seeing, apparently the sign of the mu doesn't matter. So I have lambda greater or equal to the absolute value of mu times the absolute value of mu plus 1. Agree? Because the sign of the mu does not matter. That's also valuable. That's pound. What did we do here? Well, we derived an estimate, a comparison here, an inequality between the eigenvalues, between the two eigenvalues. So you say, okay, what do I do with that estimate? Well, it will be extremely useful. Because now we'll have the third key observation. Third key observation. I just write down in formulae and then I say what it is. If you take the omega, but you don't apply it to our psi, lambda mu, but before you apply it, is there more color? Probably not as always. Seriously handicapped here. Okay. Well, let me write it in blue then too. If you apply it to J plus acting first on the psi, lambda mu, well, this should be yellow. Okay. Then you get again, you find that acting with the J plus still keeps the fact that psi j plus psi lambda mu is still an eigenvector of the omega, okay, with exactly the same eigenvalue lambda. So if psi lambda mu is an eigenvalue of omega, then the new vector j plus psi lambda mu is still an eigenvector with the same eigenvalue as regards the omega. It's just a fact. And the second fact is that if you now apply the J3 to this J plus psi lambda mu, then also for the J3, this new state that I get by acting with J plus on the psi lambda mu is still an eigenvector, but now there's a different eigenvalue. There's the eigenvalue mu plus 1. And I should say, this is the case either this is the case that these two things hold, they're still eigenvalues. No, hang on. This is, well, this is just the case, okay? This is just the case, but we need to be careful. What I wrote down was correct, and what I said was slightly incorrect. It's true that you can derive these relations. Conclusion from these relations, well, I mean, this is, okay, let's do this. So forget my statements about eigenvectors. It's just a fact that this is true, okay? Now, let's first prove it, so that it's not so mysterious. Well, so we start with omega j plus on the psi, lambda mu. I'm not always writing this. Well, let me write it, lambda mu, okay? This equals, and this is a general trick, it's a general trick. You have two operators acting in succession. You can always swap the succession, always, always. J plus after omega, and you let that act. But then you need to compensate. You need to compensate by their commutator. And the commutator is always the one in the order that the original one had. Omega J plus. Okay? You can always swap the order if you add the original order with but commutator brackets around them. Why? Well, that's the definition of the commutator. You take that term to the left-hand side and you have it, right? But for quick calculation and not making sign mistakes, swap it and keep it, but put brackets around it. That's the quick calculation rule. Saves you 1.3 seconds in the exam. Now, however, we know that the omega is a Casimir, so we know it goes out. Well, we calculated that as well, or I at least stated it. So the result is, this is lambda mu. But now here, the omega is acting first, so I know it pulls out a lambda. The lambda jumps the J plus because J plus is a linear map. So this is lambda times J plus psi lambda comma mu. Ah, yeah, there it is. First line. Okay. A. B, same thing. J3J plus on psi lambda mu. I can swap. It's J plus J3 psi lambda mu. Aha, plus I compensate of with the original order J3J plus, but with commutator brackets around it, psi lambda comma mu. Now here, this commutator J3J plus does not drop out because it's not zero. What does it help us? Well, because we know it, I said before, and it's easy to see, that J3J plus is just J3 plus, it's just J plus again. Ah, but then we know what to do. Because now, here, J3 is acting, and it produces a, in front of it, a mu. This is mu J plus psi lambda comma mu. This is simply J plus psi lambda mu. But this I can certainly write as mu plus 1 times J plus psi lambda comma mu. And that's the relations I claimed. So these are simply true. Their interpretation, however, you always keep in mind that what is an eigenvector? Can I conclude that what is in brackets here is a common eigenvector of omega and J3? Can I conclude that? Looks like it, right? Satisfies the eigenvector, eigenvalue equation. It should be an eigenvector. Unless it's zero. Thank you. Again, second time today, that's important that an eigenvector must not be zero. So it could be zero and satisfy these equations, but we wouldn't call it an eigenvector. And it is not an eigenvector. Okay? So in phrasing the conclusion, we have an important caveat. An important qualification here. Conclusion unless J plus psi lambda mu is the zero in our Hilbert space, unless that is the case, J plus psi lambda mu is a common eigenvector of omega and J3. It is a different one than the original lambda mu because it has a different mu eigenvalue here. Okay? Similarly, one obtains, or I should rather say completely analogously, one obtains that omega J minus, so instead of the plus I have a minus here, that if you do the same with the J minus acting on the psi lambda mu, then for the omega eigenvalue, the omega eigenvalue of this new vector is not a different one, it's still the lambda, but the J3 eigenvalue of the of this new guy is mu times mu minus 1 of J minus lambda mu. So the J minus, pardon me?
Just mu.
I'm sorry, thank you very much. It's just mu minus 1, J minus. So the only difference for the J minus is it lowers the eigenvalue. So the psi lambda mu had an eigenvalue mu with respect to J3. But if you first apply the J minus, it lowers the J3 eigenvalue by 1. If you apply the J plus to the C lambda mu, you increase the J3 eigenvalue by 1. That is the deepest reason here why these are called J plus and J minus, because they're so-called ladder operators. They bring you up and down. Well, that's a nice picture of them being a ladder operator, right? It's just a name for it. This is what it is, right? We calculated this. And so we have the ladder. And indeed, the rungs are always distance 1, because you start from somewhere, but it could be pi or something, right? Nobody says mu or lambda or anything is integer. Nobody said that so far. But the difference between them is always 1. And so the question is it a real-life ladder or is it a fantasy ladder? So a fantasy ladder, it would be if it doesn't have a beginning and doesn't have an end, okay? But it's a real ladder. It's a real-life ladder. How do I know there is a first and a last rung in the ladder? Well, we go back to the dollar, no, we go back to the pound equation. Now note, the pound equation said that the absolute value of mu times the absolute value of mu plus 1 is less or equal to lambda. Aha! So let's assume I start with some, so if one starts with some psi lambda mu, so we take some common eigenvector of the two, and one successively applies again and again J pluses. So I apply a J plus to the psi lambda mu. What do I know? I know that this guy has still the same lambda eigenvalue for the omega, correct? But has a mu that's 1 bigger. Okay. So that means for this new one here, the lambda is still the same, but this mu got 1 bigger. Now I can go on and on and on and on, and I can do this again and again and again. So I do J plus on that, and da da da, and J plus on that. But if the lambda always stays the same, but this mu gets bigger and bigger and bigger by going up, right? At some point, this bound will be either satisfied or broken, right? That means at some point this can no longer be true, but it is true. So what is no longer true is that this guy is actually different from zero. So if you apply the J plus often enough, you will break this bound, but that cannot be, so you must have zeroed the whole thing. So successfully applies, there comes the point after, say, capital N steps of applying this, that the J plus applied n times to the psi lambda mu is zero for all n starting with this capital Nth step and higher. You see, that's the only way out, because we seem to break this inequality, to violate it, but it can't be true that we violate it because we derived it. It's true. So the only way out is that we nulled the whole thing, and so then we no longer have these eigenvalues. Okay? So that is true for the applying successively the J plus, and similarly, you find this for the J minus. Okay, similarly, J minus N, you violate this in the other direction. Well, M lambda mu is zero for all M greater to equal to some capital M. Okay? But that means that there exists a maximum mu that, however, the maximum depends on the lambda you have, and the minimum mu that also depends on the lambda you have, so that mu, the mu you have, always lies between the maximal one, depending on the lambda, and the minimal one, depending on the lambda, but of course, like this. There's a maximal and a minimal mu value. Okay? Now, what can we further learn about this relation? We can actually, if we have that, we know such that if we apply, if we take the psi lambda comma mu, but we take not any mu, but we take the maximum mu possible for the given lambda, and we apply just one more time the J plus. Well, that's the situation up here. If I'm almost there, then I'll get zero. Similarly, if I take lambda and I take the minimum possible mu, whose existence we just concluded about, and I one more time apply the J minus, then I get this. Okay. But now we can go back to our original dollar equation. If you now go to dollar, you remember how dollar was? Dollar was an equality. It said lambda can be written in either of two ways. It can be written as the norm of J minus on the psi squared. Ah, but the J minus, well, I should actually do it now in the opposite order. J plus psi squared. But that is exactly now for this, what I've chosen here. Okay, lambda comma mu up lambda. For this one divided by blah, 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 this is zero. P plus, and here we had the mu, but now it's of course the mu bar of lambda times mu bar of lambda minus 1. Is that right? I think it was like that. Let me look it up. So I switched the lower and the upper. No, it was plus 1. And similarly, we get here 0 plus mu, but now it's for the lower one, mu lower lambda, now mu of lambda, mu lower of lambda minus 1. Okay? And that's now an equality. So we got this termination condition from an inequality, but in order to really learn again about the lambda, we go back to the stronger result, dollar. Aha! So let me write down what this is. This means lambda can be written in either of two ways. I write them on the left and on the right. It can be written as the lower mu, the lowest possible mu, as it depends on lambda, times the lowest possible mu as it depends on lambda minus 1. Or it can be written as the maximal mu as it depends on lambda times itself plus 1. Okay. This is then certainly true. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. Okay. But we know, and from the unit steps by which one arrives at mu up of lambda, starting from mu down of lambda, because if there is a lowest one, if there is a lowest mu down of lambda, and there is a highest mu up of lambda, I have unit steps between them. It follows that the difference between the highest for any given lambda and the lowest for any given lambda must be a non-negative integer. They could be the same. Could be that I apply it once and it's zero. Boom. There you go. Mm-hmm. But then you can use this fact in the equation above and you get, but thus, the lower lambda is minus, the lower mu is minus the upper mu. And now, and that's the super result here, two times, hence it follows, that two times the upper mu must lie, that's from the second equation, must lie in N0. Two times the upper mu lies in N0, or the upper mu lies in N0 half. And third, by just using the upper one, you get lambda equals the upper mu bar, the upper mu times the upper mu plus 1. That's all true.
Could you please explain where you get the first?
Okay, how was that? You use that the difference between the two. Okay, how did it grow? Ta-da-da-da-da. So you use this equal step.
To which equation? It works out, but I'm not sure whether it's necessary.
I see. Hang on, how was that? The mu is the minus mu bar. No, you factor out the minus one. You factor out the minus one. And then you compare powers. Yeah. That's it. By comparing powers of the polynomials on both sides after having factored out minus one. That's it. Okay, fine. So and that gives you the necessity of it. Mm-hmm. Okay, so you have that, and now. We have acquired by our logic the lower mu, the upper mu, a rather tricky notation with the mu up and the mu, the maximal mu and the minimal mu. Well, what really remains of importance, this is just an intermediate result, what remains of importance are these two. And it is just clever to relabel the mu bar of lambda as j. So relabel. In order to lighten the notation, so what we so far called mu bar of lambda, just call this J. That's also what people use in the literature. Then you find, and you also find if this is here and the mu's lie in between, it follows. Okay, let me write it down as a theorem immediately. Theorem. The common eigenvectors. The common eigenvectors of omega and J3 come as families. And so I'm talking about the eigenvectors. So I take the size we had, and there's the lambda came first, right? Psi lambda comma mu. But the lambda necessarily has the form j times j plus 1, where the j is half non-negative integer. Agree? This follows from here. So the lambda has the form j times j plus 1. And then there comes a mu here, mu. We may also relabel this as an m. That's not such a big relabeling. But the point is that if the j is fixed, which means fixing the lambda, then the j is the maximum possible value for this m, so the m can run from somewhere up to the j, right? Because the j is the maximum possible value for this mu given a specific lambda. That's how we constructed it. But we know the maximum possible mu, there is a minimal possible mu that's exactly minus the maximum one. So it can run from minus j to plus j. In integer steps, right, by construction. So it runs from minus j plus 1, bis da 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 da, up to j minus 1, and finally j. So the families is kind of the family name, there are many families, that's the family name, is the j, and then for a given j, there are two j many children with names m. Okay? So that's the family name. And that's the name of the children. Well, or the members of the family or whatever. Children is cuter. Okay, so no parents, only children in each family. Parents have gone to war or something. Okay, so, so you have, they come in these families. And the eigenvalues are as written down. It's just this relabeling is useful to remember the result. With omega eigenvalue j times j plus 1 and j3 eigenvalue m. Now, however, what one often does, usually, one normalizes and one defines big phis, and those are the ones one uses, phi j times j plus 1. Aha, one normalizes. Okay, let me first normalize. And then one relabels again. I mean, this is just different conventions. I just don't want you to confuse you. So this is j times j plus 1 comma m. And then one says, well, I certainly want this normalized because it's an eigenvector. The norm is non-zero comma m, right? Now I have a normalized vector. Of course, normalization doesn't change anything about the property of being an eigenvector. And I call this whole thing phi. And then, well, if I know the j times j plus 1, and I know that the j is in n0 half, then of course I can relabel this phi jm. So I, instead of always saying j times j plus 1, I say it's the jth one. But nevertheless, this jth one has omega eigenvalue j times j plus 1. Okay, this is just the labeling one normally uses. Okay? And because they're eigenvectors to different eigenvalues, and automatically, since they are all eigenvectors to different eigenvalues, and they're the operators omega and j3 are Hermitian, we also know that phi j comma m inner product with phi j twiddle comma m twiddle, so another j, another m twiddle that has the right range for g twiddle, j twiddle, is delta j j twiddle delta m m twiddle, so they're also amongst each other orthogonal, and each of them is normal, hence this follows automatically. Okay? So we have an ON system. An ON system. Nobody knows whether it's an ON basis, because we only looked at the eigenvectors. There may not be a complete basis of eigenvectors. But that is what we can learn. But then, as a corollary, so we learned all of that. But what we actually wanted to learn is the following. The J3 eigenvalue can be M, and the M can run from minus J, well, from minus J over minus J plus 1 up to j minus 1 up to j, right? That's the letter. That's the letter it can run. But because the j can be any non-negative half integer, the m runs from minus j to plus j. I can reach, if I just find the right j here, arbitrary high in both directions. So what we learned is that the m, if I disregard any fixed j, I just fixed it in order to order it. If I don't say, I look at family j and their children, I look at all the children in the world, Michael Jackson, okay? Look at all the children in the world, and then I get m is in z half, because I have the plus and the minus, okay? That is what we wanted, okay? Because then we know we found eigenvectors that are here. So I know the pure point spectrum at least must lie in here. No, sorry, the eigenvectors of this sort, the point spectrum must lie in here. Okay? That's what we found. And that is what we wanted to find. And all the J and the omega business and so on was just to get the machinery going to actually make these strong conclusions. Because quite in the beginning, when we start with omega psi is lambda psi and J3 psi is mu psi, we didn't even know lambda and mu were even integers. They could have been just anything. Okay? Well, real we knew because the operators were self-adjoint, but nothing else we knew. And look how restricted this really is. Okay? So this is the this is this. Okay, final definition, spin J systems. What is a spin J system? Well, the good thing is you already know. It's now just a matter of terminology if somebody talks about spin J. In quantum mechanics, you always talk about the entire system. You do not just... Yeah, okay. I'll write it down. Three. Well, let me call it pure spin J systems. I say pure because they're systems that have not only spin J, they have spin J and J plus 1 and J plus 3 and so on all together at the same time. And we already had such an example, namely the orbital angular momentum. Anyway, I'll define it. Definition. A quantum mechanical system is called a pure spin J system if its Hilbert space is J times J plus 1 dimensional. Oh, that's only these finite dimensional quantum systems. Okay, finite dimensional Hilbert space. So all the technology we developed is not needed for spin J systems. Is a J times J plus 1 dimensional, Hilbert space H. Okay, H. For the J, any half integer. Okay, so there are no spin three-quarter systems. Well, not in three dimensions. If you change the dimension of space to two-dimensional space, you get fractional spin. Well, one-half is also a fraction, but even more fractional, other fractions than only one-half fractions, okay? You have fractional spin, and you see this, for instance, in thin layers in the lab. You have a thin layer, and for some reason your whatever particle you look at, electron, whatnot, which has a spin attached to it, blah, 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 actually it exhibits properties that have to do with fractional spin. Okay? So, but in three dimensions, spin is always half integer valued. But this depends on the dimensionality of space. Now you might wonder about space-time, which is 3 plus 1 dimensional. However, there the calculation goes slightly differently, and the result is the same. You have in space-time, you have only half-integer spins, okay, which of course could be integer spins, right? Half-integer spins. But you also have another thing that's not spin, it's called helicity, and that's for the massless particles. But here we're non-relativistic quantum mechanics, there are no massless particles, all particles, blah, 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 blah. Okay, anyway, so this is three-dimensional non-relativistic. You have these spins, you have J in N0 half. Is it non-dimensional Hilbert space H for J and N that possesses an eigenbasis, an ON eigenbasis phi J M for M equals minus J in integer steps up to J for a set of three operators J1, J2, J3 defined on, and now because it's finite dimensional, they're all defined immediately on H. Okay? So that's a pure spin H system. Well, theorem, but that's now rather a corollary from what we said before. For a pure spin J system, the spectrum of a finite dimensional, or the finite dimensional Hilbert space is always a pure point spectrum, so we don't need to restrict to pure point, of any of these operators is always given by minus J plus 1 in integer steps up to J. That's what it always is. So if you have a pure spin zero system, what are the possible eigenvalues of your spin operators, J? Well, only zero. If you have a spin one half system, what are the possible, what's the possible spectrum of spin one half? Well, of each of the operators is always minus one half and plus one half. Okay, so example, spin, pure spin J, and a spectrum of any of the operators. What is it? Well, spin zero, spectrum consists just of the zero. It's spin one half, the spectrum consists of minus one half and plus one half. We saw this before, right? We had this C2 and da 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 da. So the Hilbert space has this dimension. Yeah. Well, then I know, not right? Well, I mean, it's wrong. Yeah. Thank you. It's 2J dimensional. I'm sorry. It's 2J dimensional. And a 2J dimensional complex Hilbert space is always C to the 2J. No. Hang on. C to the 2J, J is and
huh? C to the J.
No, now I'm confused. The Hilbert space. Hang on, J. Huh? Now I'm confused. Okay, so the question is the number of steps I have here is 2J plus 1. Okay, I'm sorry. So it's clear that these are 2J plus 1 numbers, and then the Hilbert space is 2j plus one dimensional, and then if it's, because it's finite, it's always the c to the 2j plus 1. And in our, you remember I gave you this example of c2, that's for j equals 1 half. Well, indeed, that is what we found there. Then you can have spin 1, that's minus 1, 0, plus 1, and so on. Well, this is for massive stuff. It wasn't for massive. Well, yeah, so the electron has, on top of its L3, it actually has a c2. So the real electron, non-relativistic, has a Hilbert space. Well, it's a particle that moves in R3, so it has this Hilbert space, but it also has additionally this spin 1 half attached to it, so it's a composed system out of a translational degree of freedom and a spin 1 half, and in quantum mechanics, you compose systems by taking the tensor product of the Hilbert spaces. We'll do that next time, how to compose quantum mechanical systems, okay? So this is just, well, I should say next time later, okay? But maybe next time, I'm thinking about it, okay? That you compose that. But that's the real electron. It can move, and it has additionally a spin 1 half. Mm-hmm. So you have this. If this was not massive but massless, when you have helicity, you only have the extremal values, minus 1, plus 1. You have the photon with two different polarizations. If you go down up to 2 and you're massless, you have the graviton, if any such thing exists, okay? And so on and so on. Okay, but I'm extending a little bit away from the non-relativistic domain, but it's not too wrong. Okay, so if you are, the graviton has spin 2, ah, pure spin 2, great, I know. It's just its helicity too, but anyway. So you have this here. And I had one more remark, did I? Ah, yeah, and of course, important example for a non-pure spin J system, non-pure system, spin system, and that will be on the problem sheet. It is the spectrum of the LJs, where this is the orbital angular momentum we introduced last time, and we started with orbital angular momentum. And that one has as its spectrum Z, okay? So it cannot be any J system, because the J system has as the eigenvalues of, say, the L3, I could specialize to L3, but for the others the same. Neither of these, they get bigger and bigger and bigger. The higher the J gets, the bigger these guys get, okay? But this one needs all of these families, right? So the angular momentum, the orbital angular momentum, is not pure spin 1, spin 2, spin 3. It depends on which orbit you're on, what spin you have. And the higher out you go, the higher the J gets, and then you have, for these guys in there, always this range. Okay? That is why for the levels of the hydrogen atom, you will label them by energy and by the J and by the M. Those will be eigenstates of the hydrogen atom, because here the E is the eigenvalue of the Hamilton operator. So you have the common eigenvectors of all of those. Okay? So the orbital angular momentum is not a pure spin. It's kind of all kinds of spins together. And that makes sense because its Hilbert space is something like the sum of all these pure J Hilbert spaces. So I could call this an HJ. So it has a sum over all of them. Okay. Good. So you cannot say angular momentum, what is its spin? Well, it depends on the state. All the families appear in the angular momentum. But there are these other systems like spin 1 half, where it's only one very specific J family and its children that make up the, well, that make up the system. Okay? Questions? Okay, thank you. Thank you for your patience.